Hello everyone, I'm Mason. You guys told me maybe to take 2-3 hours of breakfast. Is that barbecue?
Yeah.
Perfect.
The beer, there's enough beer for this.
No, it's okay. We're gonna take 45-60 minutes snacks. Of course, then thanks for Q&A. But today's topic is big data analytics on textual data. Mainly, I will speak about this topic with a reference to our Jupyter One platform that I'm going to show first. But first, let me introduce myself. I'm a data scientist at Crossing Technologies. My name is Jacob Krstic, and I'm also organizer of Data Science Croatia. We have same goals like guys here to emphasize the importance of data science in today's environment, and of course to educate people, not just the students, but also right from the high school, to motivate people, to tell them how data science is influencing people today, and of course show them the examples of that influence in today's world. We have almost every month one meetup lecture, call it as you want, and we are trying to decentralize that topic to all over the Croatia, because Croatia is the most decentralized country in Europe. Everything is in Zagreb, so we are trying to pull the knowledge also to the other areas in Croatia, from the east, west, north, out, in all the parts of Croatia. Also, we are joining with the universities. We have full support from the professors, and we have our meetups mostly on universities. That's the main part. If you're interested in data science Croatia, you can visit us on. Just let me check here. You can visit us on meetup.com. So this is our Data Science Croatia page. As guys told us, why it's so Croatian, no English? But okay, we are doing the efforts to do it bilingual, Croatian and English. Our main goal was to provide data science content on Croatian, because everything's on English, and so let's do it against the flow and put something on Croatian. Let's go back to the. Where's my cursor now? Let's go back to the presentation. Functionalities of Jupyter One for mainly for for the text mining cases that we're going to show. As you know, in the description of this meetup, we have three cases: UN selections, Croatian politics elections, and of course the Brexit. I'm going to show you two full analysis for US elections and from Croatian politics, so you can see the comparison why, mainly because of the volume, of course. And the Brexit case, I will show you the real-time graphs and the analysis in the Jupiter one. So what is Jupiter one? Our main goal in the beginning of the company, we are just 2 years old, was to build a tool, to build a platform that's based on big data technologies to analyze social media at the beginning. Why social media? Because our clients wanted to analyze opinion on Facebook and Twitter mostly at the beginning. And later we evolved something a little bit different, not just text mining, but also social network analysis, log analysis, clickstream analysis, behavior analysis, and so on. Depending on the customers, we created more and more functionalities. So, but today I will concentrate mostly on the text mining part, and of course if you want to see something else, maybe later in the Q&A part we can go deeper in some other fields here. So,
I guess it makes it full screen, right?
Yeah, but then it's stuck. Okay, it works. So many functionalities. As I told you, Jupiter One is built on top of big data architecture. So of course we have one real-time screen, and on the other hand, we have a batch mode, as you can see here. So as the data systems part, we have existing relational level, also Hadoop databases, but of course here we have some more general marketing stuff, functionalities, like we have cool user friendly to restricted areas and so on and so on. But the main part is the text mining. Regarding the text mining, all of the machine learning is done in real time, so all of the processing and everything is in real time. Main point was that user can see in the Jupiter one the comment with the flags specific to that comment. For example, what is the sentiment score for that comment, what is the gender of that person who wrote that comment, and so on and so on. So as you will see later in our architecture part, I will show you how this is done step by step. But except the text mining part, we developed our own, let's call it, self-service BI on top of the Hadoop. So it's mostly real-time visualization made in Jupiter One. We are connected directly to a bunch of Druid and then visualizing like all of cubes. Let's go that way in the real time in the Jupiter one. So as I stated earlier, the first part was social media. So that's the left part blue over there, source one, source two, source three. So we have different sources, of course. We have social medias from Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, and so on, YouTube, for example. But we also have, of course, data warehouse from the internal data. We have maybe some flat files, some Excel files, as it usually is that way. Maybe some logs in JSON format or something like that. And we have different structures. Some data are structured, some data are unstructured, so that's why we had to use, of course, big data in order to accompany this part. So the blue part is the sources. The next part is the analysis that we do. As I said, instead it's mostly we have gender prediction, sentiment analysis, name entity extraction, topic modeling, social network analysis, and so on and so on. And machine learning is done in our cases either on the development, either in our Python and in H2O as machine learning platform for our company. We decided to use only H2O in order to simply embed those algorithms in the Java code behind the scenes in the big data architecture. And on the right part, we have report visualization or report or outputs in different files, for example, in Hive tables or some flat files, or we have some customer that wanted to the CSV file as output or anything else. So the actual architecture looks like this. It's a little bit outdated, the look, but the main part is here. So this will be the real time, this is the batch part. As you will see today, you will see the reports made in Tableau, and not just in Tableau, but also in our Jupyter1 platform. Everything is scalable to and responsive design to mobile phones, tablets, and so on. So we have different sources, as I said, either internal or external, which all comes to the real-time part over here. We use Storm. We had a debate to either use Spark or Storm. Spark or Storm, but eventually we decided to use Storm because we thought it's a better solution and we didn't regret it. Even though the Spark real time also is made wonderfully. We use Spark for the, let's call it, mostly in our cases for topic modeling in our cases. So we use LDA algorithm in this case for topic modeling in Spark. It's more of a batch job, not the real time part, as you can see over here. Some of the...
Can you go back?
Uh-huh. Okay.
May I interrupt your...
Yeah, okay.
Can you a little bit explain the structure? What are the inputs, for example, of the social and the which data you have taken?
Okay.
And for what reason are you using Kafka in Storm?
So mostly what are the inputs and how it's processed all the way?
Yes.
It has the architecture in global. So, of course, we are using social media APIs. We have some partnership with companies like NIP to connect, for example, to Twitter right to the firehose, to use directly data from the firehose. Since the Twitter has a restriction, you can go in the default mode, you can go only 14 days or so in the backwards in the history, right? So if you set some keyword like for example Trump, you can go back only a couple of weeks. But we have that access to the firehose, we can go even further and we can search the comments that are our interest. So for example, we have user interface, which is in the Jupyter1 platform. User creates projects, creates keywords and group of keywords. So for example, in the case of the US elections, our main goal is to compare Donald Trump versus Hillary Clinton. So we created one group of keywords that have main goal to find comments that contain word like Donald Trump. And in the other case, that contain name of Hillary Clinton. So the main part of that keyword extraction job is to filter the huge amount of data coming from Facebook and Twitter and only pass through the content of interest. this is the same case for the pages. But the main difference between Twitter and Facebook is because Twitter is pure real-time social media. You can get data practically, as I said, in five goes. But on the Facebook, you have a different approach. In our case, is user defines public Facebook pages, Facebook groups, basically IDs of the Facebook pages that we want to monitor and find the keywords over there. Of course, for the official pages, like official page of Donald Trump, we collect all of the comments on that page. So we get the volume. And the third main part regarding this social media, text analytics, and so on, is the, let's call it the crawler, data ingestion part. Of course, why? Because social media like Facebook and Twitter are not enough. We need to crawl the famous, I don't know, the most viewed news portals in the US, in the UK, in Germany, Croatia, and so on and so on. And of course, each page is different, and it can be a lot of complicated situation when you go to crawl exact pages. So we have two approaches over there. Basically, we give to the customer predefined templates of what they're gonna crawl. In the term of US elections, for example, we have for, I don't know, New York Times, the template, how to crawl that page, for Croatian news portals, how to crawl each page. So we have templating, but also users can define the steps of the crawling process by themselves. What that means? So practically in Jupyter One, user opens the main page of the main page of that portal of interest. For example, let's take New York Times. And first part is to select how to extract links, why links, because of course portal have thousands, even millions of links, but we only want to target, I don't know, category politics or maybe category US elections, and we want to only crawl those articles. And then when we have the definition for the link extraction part, then we go to the process how to crawl each page. So that practically means user clicks on that page which is embedded in Jupyter One interface and say, okay, I'm going to click on the title and rename it Tokyo. Something similar, maybe if you're familiar with import IO tool, something similar, but in our cases, we used different technology, and in some more complicated cases, we go even deeper and we use Selenium to imitate the user. So we practically click next, all the way to the down. But why? Because we have some web pages that were too complicated, a lot of JavaScript behind, and we had to simulate the user. It's much slower, but at the end we get the final result. We get what we want, and that's the articles that are trying to present the idea, I don't know, regarding Trump and regarding Hillary Clinton. And when we collect all of those data in Twitter, Facebook, web crawling, and so on, everything is directly put in our storm part, and then the analysis begins. We then analyze each of the comments. We must assign them to the correct project. We must assign them the correct keyword extraction, gender prediction, sentiment score, and so on, depending on the analysis. As you saw in the previous picture, we tried to do it like Lego bricks. So practically user puts a Lego brick of interest. So for example, some users want to use only sentiment analysis, some users are not interested at all in sentiment analysis. They only want to use, I don't know, Facebook and Twitter resources, they want to use keyword extraction, and that's it. They just want to count how many of comments have the word, I don't know, Donald Trump in it, embedded in it. And at the end, here we maybe miss the part where we use the Druid Apache Druid project is used for the creation of real-time aggregations, like, let's call it like that way. Why? Because we need to present here to the user, I don't know, how many messages in total do we have regarding that project, or maybe, I don't know, let's split the total amount of comments that we collected on the gender base, on the source base, and so on and so on. So, from the beginning to the end, the main point is always that one comment. Of course, we always are collecting not just the original comment, but also the snapshot of each comment, because the states changes, number of likes, number of replies to that comment, and everything is changeable during the time. So we have to have each snapshot in these cases. And that's regarding the real time, and Tableau once a day collects all the data, aggregates them, and builds, I don't know, customer specific reports. So, for example, customers gives us a specification how they want to the reports to look like, so we make even the report customizations and so on and so on. We mentioned this one that we use data sources. Maybe I didn't mention location intelligence. Maybe this feature is still in beta. Why? Because we had only one project in Asia where we worked on the location intelligence part. The main goal was to find the users who click on real estate. Real estates in Asia. So practically we give the customer the map of Southeast Asia and the real estate that were clicked in real time, and what are the average prices, I don't know, sources of that people who clicked on that, and so on and so on. That's regarding that. Regarding the this part is more on economical part of Jupyter One. Our main goal was to build, as I said, a big data analytics platform for the users. So make it more simple. You know, when people go to big data projects, they mostly back up or make projects fail because people think it's a lot of cost, it's a lot of time to go into big data, and we try to simplify the process from the beginning to the end. So that's why we try to do our big data projects in a matter of weeks, not just months, only years in some cases. So we try to push it as fast as we can at the beginnings, at the beginning of the stages. And then we customize the Jupyter One based on the needs of the customers. Okay, this is regarding the balanced and flexible sources that we must cope with, the social media, not just social media, data warehouse, flat files, and so on. But the main part is always, if you ever work with R or these modern packages which are very popular, is to summarize to this. We must allow the customer to easily import the data, no matter what source, no matter is it social media, is it flat files, is it something else. We must provide the customer the simple interface to perform some typing, either in SQL or in drag and drop like interface. No matter what, we must provide it with transformation, and then comes the most interesting part for me, the modeling and the visualization of those data. So for example, for the sentiment analysis, we already have predefined models for sentiment analysis for, let's say, English, for some, not Croatian, but some Slavic region, let's call it ex-Yugoslav countries. Why? Because it's easier. And those are all custom models built on the data that we collected. For example, in Croatian cases, I know if you know, we don't even have a proper stop word list for Croatian language. So we have some sources, but it's not on the level like, for example, for the English, for the German, or something like that. So, for example, we use lemmatization instead of stemming, if you're familiar with those terms. So we had to practically, in cooperation with faculty, faculties in the University of Zagreb, to work on custom dictionary for lemmatization in that case. So to improve the accuracy of the model and so on. Of course, we build eventually our own stop word list. We created our own parts that we need in this part here to properly tidy our data. And the last part, of course, communication. Okay, we have a project. We have some graphs moving up and down, up and down. Is that what we want? Do we want something different, or maybe something totally else? So now I'm going to show you the use cases one by one. As I mentioned, I will first show you the batch report. This is not the report that we use in production. This is a report that I built for the purposes of the meetup. And the data are, of course, from the last year when the elections happened. But the point is over there. Let me just click over here. Do we have questions maybe regarding this part? Questions? No questions. Okay. So U.S. elections. As I stated earlier, the logic in the Jupyter one. Okay, we have one project. That project has a goal. This project has a goal to analyze comments about Trump and comments about Clinton, and to conclude something. Right. So, in order to build a project, we must select sources. In these cases, I selected only Facebook and Twitter. Maybe the Twitter will be the most interesting because Donald Trump likes Twitter. But okay, Facebook plus Twitter. These are the sources. The keywords for this case were simple. We are searching for Donald Trump, and we are searching for Hillary Clinton in the comment. No matter what, so the comment must contain those words in order to classify them. Okay, this is a comment of our interest. And then it comes to the Jupyter one, it's analyzed, sentiment, blah, 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 as I mentioned earlier, and the final result is in this case, it's 250 million around. It's not the only data, it's practically a subset, I show you here how many comments Hillary Clinton had and how many Donald Trump, and of course the graph is colored based on the keywords that we found. So for example, we call it here, as you can see, online presence. We practically named the metric in the Jupyter one, online presence is practically every mention of that keyword in the comment space in the whole corpus. And of course, in this case, it's splitted by the date. And here I put the election day, so you have the reference point. So this is just one metric, online presence. So practically we are counting how many comments contains either Donald Trump keyword, that is the red line, and Hillary Clinton, the blue one. And we can now compare, is there any difference in the matches? So for example, here we have a spike, this is mostly the similar. For example, after the elections, we can see the Donald Trump up and high. Here we have Hillary Clinton. And if we go even further from here to 2017, you will see that Hillary Clinton practically totally vanished from the social media space. And of course, Donald Trump remains much higher than Hillary Clinton. Can we predict the election based on this metric? Not so. But it is interesting to see the online presence, to see maybe sentiment analysis also the same view as here, maybe which is the more negative, the more positive. But it's not what you would expect. The differences are very, very small in this case.
A quick question. How did you define the keywords after which you basically grouped it into to Trump and Clinton? Because and the follow-up question maybe is how robust was the selection? Like if you removed from one group one of the keywords, would this change anything?
If I remove, for example, so practically when we are defining a project, we must tell what group of keywords is associated with Donald Trump. In this case, as I said, I made it quite simple. Comment must contain Donald and Trump, no matter what is the position in the text. So, for example, I made it more flexible. It doesn't have to be Trump right after the Donald, but I can put whatever I want. I can put strictly Donald Trump, or I want to find only Trump, or I want to find comments that contain only Donald Trump but not Hillary Clinton and so on. I can use the operators in that case. And for example, if in the middle of project I remove some keywords, the Jupyter one takes the only active configuration. Data are still over there, but the user will only see what's currently active in the project. So
yes.
So the next part is here online presence with percent of negative comments in Tokyo, just for the comparison with the election day here. Election day, so you can see the difference. And as you can see here, it's almost the same curve. There are some days, of course, when Donald Trump leads, some days when Hillary Clinton. But the main difference here is the, of course, the online presence in some situations.
I would have suspected a great difference between the positive and the negative sentiment.
Could you repeat the question?
I would have suspected a great difference between Trump and Clinton regarding the sentiment, so that it would be more positive or more negative for one either candidate, but it's almost the same.
Yeah. The best way is to use the whole three groups in comparison, for example, negative, positive, and neutral, and maybe to put in these cases here just for the Hillary Clinton and this for just for the Donald Trump, and we can see the whole three groups as a trend. So maybe we can conclude something in that case. This is just percent of negative. Maybe if I put here the percent of positives, maybe for the different graph. But the problem is we have a lot of negative comments in both cases, as you can see here, this is the 80%. And when we go to the Croatians, it's even worse. Croatians don't like to put positive comments on them. It's quite simple. When we tried to build a sentiment analysis model for Croatian language, it was a total mess. Total mess, why? Because we couldn't find on online decent amount of positive comments to go to the learning of the sentiment model. We had to use some tricks, for example, to go find famous singers, food channels, and so on. Okay. But we made it eventually. Still, you cannot reimagine the positive comments if the spectrum of operation is mostly negative, then that's the truth. So, for example, we had to build for curation banking industry analysis. So practically we had to analyze all the banks in Croatia. Among them, of course, we have Austrian banks. By the way, Austrian banks have the lowest sentiment score. Italians are the best. But some people from the banks told said to us, how could it be? How many, I don't know, 10,000 negative comments on that specific day? So we had to practically drill down all the way to the specific content and show them the 10,000 negative comments that were made on that day, and the reaction was, oh, okay, go on. For example, we also had a very interesting case for the retail industry. It was a holiday in Croatia. We have, let's go, I wouldn't put names here, but we have number one and number two retailer. So number two retailer didn't work at all on the holiday. Number one, of course, worked all day, all night. And the positive comments for the number two were huge, huge. The difference was even bigger than here after the Trump war. It was brutal difference in the comments in the online spectrum. And when you know that Croatians are mostly negatives, and you find one little high peak in those data, it means something in this case.
How do you handle irony?
Yeah, that's the problem, especially in Croatia. We have a million versions of irony, not irony, but yeah, it's statistics.
Okay.
We have 70% accuracy, so in that case, so okay. We are not trying to find the, I don't know, to correctly predict each comment, to I don't know, build some magic box. We are just trying to see the trend. So we are trying to present the customer, okay, this is your trend in the past year, so let's do a comparison, you versus the other brands. So maybe we can find out something in that cases. So if you can see here, mostly is on Twitter in both cases. Trump dominates in both sources, but here are some interesting parts. For example, top pages. As you can see here, Donald J. Trump had 3.6 million mentions of Hillary Clinton. So also here, on Hillary Clinton page, we had 2.7 million mentions of Donald Trump. So there are some interesting things. Of course, Fox News is obsessed with both of them, and NBC News, CNN, and so on. We monitored maybe, I don't know, in this case it's only 10 news portals. So when you see here 50 million, that addresses only to, in this case, is to those 10 pages. Regarding the gender part, this is absolute relative, of course, and we can see that pretty much the same in those cases. But here, in the number of likes part, you can see the after the election part of over 10 million likes in this case. While, of course, Hillary Clinton, you can see the spikes here. Donald Trump has different spikes over here, and so on. So we can track the number of likes. Of course, some of it also useful analysis that I didn't show here would be, I don't know, which are the most influenced persons online. For example, we will search them by author name or user ID or whatever you want. So which of them are the most influenced in the online space? So if we go here, we see that we have 250 million, but if we go here to the Croatian politics, and if you go to the pretty much the similar graph, you will see this is okay, actually this is just 1 month, but still 42,000 messages for 1 month in comparison to the Donald Trump news collection, the difference is of course huge. You don't have to remember the names, we will call them candidate 1, candidate 2 and so on. I don't know if you know, Croatia had elections yesterday, so they're finalized. It's the local level, not the highest parliament level. And this is the battle for the main city for the Zagreb. So battle between left wing, right wing, central wing, and there are some also extreme candidates over here. But for example, the result is interesting. I will try to explain why. For example, candidate number one, Bruna, in these cases, has a huge online presence. And this is very, very weird. Why? Because Bruna didn't appear on television at all. Didn't participate in the debate, didn't perform much of the digital marketing, offline marketing. This was made purely by, let's call it, their fans. She didn't win elections, but she outnumbered candidate this one here. This is from the main party. They are huge favorite on the right wing, so she practically stole a lot of spectrum of that right wing, which was not maybe seen in traditional media. When you go to traditional media news portal and you scroll down the news, maybe you go to see the debate and so on, you didn't anticipate this. But Bruna had twice as much votes than candidate number three. Of course, we have another weird situation here. This is the candidate over here, Milan. He ran Zagreb for maybe 16 years or so. He was the total ruler of the main city in Croatia. And if you can see, he's not online at all. Only 2,000 comments. And this is because he had his offline campaign practically containing just two words: I live Zagreb, and that's it. So the message was, I'm here 16 years and I will be here, I'm the greatest, and so on and so on. But he wasn't online at all, and when you see the results from yesterday, he again won, but it wasn't a victory as in previous cases where he totally destroyed his competitions. In these cases he had around 30%. This candidate over here has, I think, 25% in total, and they are going to the second round to fight for the mayor office, right?
And Bruna? Hmm? Bruna was just an online phenomenon.
Yo, she had, I think, around 11%, it's not as much as high as, for example, Milan, but it's huge result for the right wing, since Zagreb is known for their voters to be the left, so for example, we have Sandra. Sandra was practically part of Milan team. So she split during the last 2 years and we stole some of the votes in this case, since she had a lot of views. Of course, these two candidates were the lowest. I think the Ivan was better than Marko, but they didn't have some memorable result in these cases.
The source of the data, Facebook?
Facebook and Twitter, but one main difference in comparison to the US elections, Croatians don't use Twitter. Mm-hmm. We have really, really small community regarding Twitter, so practically 95 to 98% of the comments were from the Facebook, from the top 10 pages, plus official pages of the candidates. So this is the online presence part for the, I put here the this quarter, but practically this means only month. So since we have only one month, if we click number of likes, you will see the results is practically the same here. If we go to the sentiment score, you can see that there are some, we cannot use sentiment score in this case, for example, to predict the elections, because these two candidates go to the second round. These two, Sandra made a good campaign, had a good result, but she's not the one in this case. Okay, let me go. What time it is? It's gonna be 3 hours, as I said.
It's 2%, so it's left a couple more minutes.
Okay, so this is the part we can use this as. I put here the Anka and Milan, the part that goes to the second round, just for the comparison. And we have here some strange spike. I had to check why, but it seems like this was the day when the debate was on Croatian national television. And Milan was practically not mentioned at all in the comments on the Facebook below the debate, video debate. And everybody spoke about Anka in comparison with other candidates. Milan was, he's gonna be in the second round anyway. Let's concentrate on the second candidate. Who can win Milan? So practically that is the case. If we see the sentiment score, we can see that Milan has these likes, little more accent in comparison to Anka. And regarding the when people write, which is a long goodbye, mostly Tuesday, here we have two spikes regarding Friday and Saturday.
One question.
Yes?
To the previous graph, have you been able to relate like sentiment scores or presence with events like TV shows?
Yeah.
Special findings?
Yes, since we have a web crawler, as I mentioned earlier, I didn't put it in this case, we have on Facebook and Twitter, but the complete case would be to use also the web crawler live, because when people write comments below on Facebook or maybe on Twitter, they like to share the original article or the reference to the video, and in that way we can collect that URL and, for example, put here like I put the election day, maybe to put, okay, this is the debate on television, maybe this is the huge, negative points for Milan because he was in court for some reasons, and I don't know, so we can track those. Or maybe in the case of the retail, we can put national holidays. Why? Because we saw it's important, because people relate on that level. We had two cases, but let me go. This one. This is the Jupiter one and the real time part for the Brexit. This is not the Brexit from the last year when the Brexit referendum was. This is Brexit practically now. I think in this case it's mostly Twitter. I think the Facebook is on hold in this case, but never mind. So practically the point is to show that people are still talking about Brexit, especially now when the negotiation between European Union and Brexit are on the way. So you can practically see here that these are the direct messages coming from the Twitter into Jupiter One, and directly are shown here in the graph. And over here we have score, we have class, we have timestamp, we can put additional dimensions like gender, or maybe source, or maybe something.
I'm really fast. Do you, your algorithm recognize the language and make the negative or positive based on the language, or
So when we collect the comment, we get the information from the source.
Okay.
What kind of language is it? Is it English, German, Croatian, something like that? In the Twitter case, the language detection doesn't work very well.
Okay.
So we created, let's call it a backup language detector.
Okay.
So practically we have created our own custom language detector, and we are comparing two values to see are they matching, and based on the final judgment, when we know okay this is English, then we know which sentiment model to use, of course, because we use English sentiment model for English, we use Croatian for Croatian, and so on. So this is the Brexit. Let me go back here. Just to show you the, oh sorry, I had it here, America, make America great again. This is the current version, and in this case we are only monitoring the Donald Trump in this case, and I think I'll put on a couple of metrics. Split it by source. So on the left we have Facebook, on the right we have Twitter, and we have online presence versus sentiment analysis in this case. So that's practically it regarding this one. Just let me
pick this for this month.
Today is 22nd, right? Yeah. Why?
Just
so
is there a spike on I don't know, on weekdays or weekends, what do you think? Looks pretty curly.
Curly, yeah, because this is the graph that we call it spline, which we have two options, to use lines, to use splines. This one is on purpose curly. So we are connecting the dots on the curly way. So different way of drawing things we can use. Maybe I can show you the when we order the visualization part. We have here enable editing. So for example, I go here and I select one of the graph. As you can see, this is a grid. You can drag and drop. You can do whatever you want. But when you click here, edit. Loading. So this is our, maybe you remember when I mentioned our real-time visualization is a bit later. So practically we are communicating with Druid again. We split the here, we have dimensions and metrics, and you can easily drag and drop. For example, you can drag and drop JavaScript here, like classic self-service BI, like Power BI, like Tableau, like other tools. You can go here, you can select, we call it spline. The spline is this curly one, but we can choose, for example, just the lines. We can choose the pie, scatterplot, heat maps, tables, the list, showing the exact comments, and so on and so on. Maybe I just one more thing to go here to the topics. As I mentioned earlier, topics are built in a batch mode, not in real time. So practically this means we are defining batch jobs. For example, collect all messages regarding Make America Great Again project, split them in date subsets, for example, what happened yesterday, what happened this week, this month, this quarter, this year, and based on that subset, create and topics. In this case, since we talked about yesterday, we have only three topics, and each topic is represented in the Jupyter one with a word log, top 20 words, I think, by significance. And what we have here, for example, the word cloud for topic 1, topic 2, topic 3, and for example, you can rename it to topic 1 and say put Donald Trump human rights in Saudi Arabia, something like that, something meaningful to you, and maybe conclude something. So we do allow some words to go in different topics, but in this case we have some different words in combination with Donald, Saudi Arabia, and so on, like King, Trip, UI Fund, so on, and maybe
the color indicated by the color, right, or by the size, or how does it?
Size is by significance, so the largest is the most significant.
And the color is ordered to the color.
Mm-hmm. Basically. Color is here just to distinct them.
So no meaning. No meaning.
In this case, no meaning. Just the height. So for example, here we have something different, like President POTUS. POTUS is the first name of Donald Trump Twitter. I know Muslim cooperation, salesman speech, la 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 la, text, something like that.
So you define certain keywords and you search Twitter for these keywords.
We created a project, as you saw earlier, on the in the U.S. election case.
Right.
So with topic modeling, we are attacking that corpus that we use to analyze U.S. elections. Mm-hmm. We can maybe use some different subset, but we can easily in the config part say, okay, use U.S. elections only last 3 months.
Right.
Where we have only Donald Trump, for example, and we want to build topic modeling on that. So why topic modeling? Because the point here is to see with unbiased methods what are the most important topics in that time period. Could you say?
So, for example, if you want to catch the tweets from Donald Trump, mm-hmm. you define Donald and Trump and POTUS. But sometimes the same, so Donald Trump maybe within one tweet, and so this would count as two, because it counts for Donald and for Trump, or will it just count once?
So if we have a tweet that contains Donald and Trump, so we count it just as one, one comment that contains some group of keywords specified for Donald Trump. We have in the database which keywords are found in that comment, so if you want, we can use additional analysis and maybe split it. How many times do we have just Trump, combination Donald plus Trump, combination Donald Trump with Hillary Clinton, or you can know whatever you want in the customization part, but in the let's call default part, we put, okay, we have one comment that contains some word that you specify to find Donald Trump in this case. I think that's it. Questions?
So, thanks to Gito. Yeah. Questions are now open.
Can you distinguish somehow between real people and bots?
We try to use find specific features which we can use to build a machine learning model to detect some fake accounts, for example, not just the bots. We have a lot of fake accounts in the political case in Croatia. It's mostly, of course, person without friends, or let's say 40 below friends, or there are some indicators, but of course we didn't put it still in the production phase. We are just now experimenting to find which is the proper metric methodology to use in that case, because that is also the problem we have also in the dialogue. The Trump case, as you remember, Macedonia was a great part of the Twitter spectrum because a lot of bots, a lot of fake accounts, a lot of fake news came from Macedonia. A lot of people got rich in Macedonia based on that. So.
I have another quick question. Mm-hmm. Have you ever, in this, there was this one chart where you displayed how many tweets Hillary Clinton appeared in and Donald Trump. Have you ever checked by how many people, like the average rate of the average tweeting rate of a contributor of someone who tweets? Because I suppose that the Trump people who tweet for Trump are way less, but they tweet at average way more than people who tweet for Hillary Clinton. Is it right?
Yeah. So there are not just in our cases, but you can find it also those kind of analysis on Twitter. A lot of people, a lot of scientists show that practically that's something different. That's more of social network analysis and direct theory of networks. They show that there are some users that made huge influence in that case. Is of course there is a huge chunk that was fake news, fake accounts and so on. That's why that there is a huge media attack. We have to cope with the fake accounts, with the fake news. There was a lot of pressure on Facebook. You have to filter the fake news and so on and so on. Regarding us, regarding Jupyter One, when we import data, when I use the simple distribution of how many comments each user provided to our corpus, there were some outliers. For example, we could easily detect, in the manual process, okay, these are the bots that generated a lot of tweets in this case, but also influenced on other users, because users retweeted it, put it maybe on Facebook and so on, and that's why it's important to use also the data ingestion part, where we have the original URL, we have the complete article, and we can track the content of that article, how it's shared on the social media, on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, or something.
One more question. You showed us your analysis on very unique names, Donald Trump, Hillary Clinton. When I go, for example, for A1, the communications company here, you have A1, the communications company, you have A1, the petrol stations, you have A1, the highway. Could you distinguish that?
Yeah, with simple keyword detection, it will be hard. In that case, you could use some variation, for example, the main theme in the main article, in the main, post must be related to, for example, for telecommunication, for mobile, and then try to find the proper keys. But the proper way to cope with that would be, of course, to build a custom, let's call category classification, something like that, to classify all the corpus, first of all, to find the telco-related cases, and then to try to find the specific keywords like telco number one, telco number two, three, and so on. It's, of course, a little bit more complicated in that case. We have also in Croatia some, for example, the name of the telco means also the telco. It means totally different, something in Croatian language, it's something funny or something. Even, I don't know.
Afterwards, I'd
appear. More questions?
More questions. And then, one last question.
find correlations between like the presence and the sentiment in your election cases with the way the opinion polls were pre-election phase?
Yeah, yeah. With the classical traditional opinion polls, right? Mm-hmm. So some correlation in the sentiment metrics, not so, but in the topic part, yes. Why? Because, for example, in, not just in Croatia, but in general, politicians like to comment the polls results, like the poll. It's practically always the negative, and then nothing, I'm going to win, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that, and then the discussion connects to that one. So, some cases, for example, in our region, it's always difficult to track those things. Why? Because, I don't know, things start with how to cook pasta, and when you scroll down to the comment number 100, they already came to the World War II, and who was on which side, who fought, blah, blah, blah. So it's totally different. And in Croatia, it's always whatever the main topic is, when you scroll down to the 100th comment, we are already in the World War II. If you go deeper, maybe we are in the Roman Empire or something.
Discussion.
What would also be interesting, have you tried to correlate the stock for
We really did work on that level. That's a very interesting case. One of the first in the implementation of sentiment analysis in a production case is where they try to correlate sentiment analysis with the stocks. And so we have one firm, not from one group of guys that tried to do that in the Croatian market, but it didn't bring spectacular results because we are really a very small country, we are a very concentrated country, and practically only a group of people owns pretty much everything. So, for example.
And does Jupyter One also support extracting the data that you generate? Mm-hmm. Do you use it in your data?
So we provide user either high tables, flat files, Tableau extracts, or those are the main. In some cases, we give them the API access, or maybe just the JSON files. Depending, for example, we use JSON output for the, in some cases, for the config download or something like that. We have both version. People usually take cloud version because they think, of course, it's as a service, it's cheaper, I can drop out after 6 months, 7 months, blah, blah, blah. But we have, I would say, three major on-premise installations in Croatia. The one main was Croatian National Bank. So they use the on-premise installation of the Jupyter One. But that was just social media. It was something new. Okay.
So then I have a last question, more technical. I think you have already answered it, but you're using mainly text as a short editor. Are you also using the network information? So like graph analysis. And second, are you thinking about including and mixing it with new types of data? I specifically think about center data, for example, which is often talked about as the new wave, because you are now more or less with data. This is what data scientists thrive on for the last years now, with all types of analysis, but the next wave, maybe the type of things is coming. So what do you think about that?
So we started with just actually double play to be, of course, build connectors for data warehouses for specific like Oracle, like Oracle just for the logs. We use flat files, we connected to even some external files. For example, we had a case in telecom industry where we had to correlate weather data with the failures in the internal data. We had, regarding the Internet of Things data, we don't have, let's call it a pure Internet of Things case, but the most interesting part, which we haven't started yet, but it is interesting to me, is the Internet of Things in agriculture. Why? Because we in Croatia have a lot of group of startups that are agriculture specific. They use drones, they use a lot of sensors data, a lot of metrics, so there is a need to use big data architecture in that case to put those data in the big data architecture, analyze it, visualize, export, and do whatever we want.
Network information.
We had one pure, let's call it big data case, where we had to connect to IBM Q radar, which scans all the network and gives us all the data, and it was the huge amount coming to the Jupiter 1 in that case. So we had to use the power of big data in that way to analyze all the network data to see, are there any security threats for the network? Are there in that case?
I meant network information. Who is connected to whom is social network?
Okay. Okay, sorry. I didn't show you. Maybe I should. We have, if you remember on the left part, we had some icons. We had one specific icon for social network analysis. So it's solely for social network, where you can configure your project. So practically, you can select the subset, small graph, whatever you think of it. What is the point of interest in your case, and you have the social network analysis and visualization embedded in the Jupyter launch. And not just that, we have some predefined social network analysis and algorithms which user can choose, select, visualize, or regarding the centralities between us, the page rank algorithms, and so on. So we have that in Jupyter 1, that it was built in the third stage of development because of the need in the client.
So really, really cool logical, and then one first